This is the Office Hour 7th edition for financial modeling. And today we are talking about that there are two broad categories of companies that you will have to do financial models for. Right? There's the traditional company, which is what we've been working on all the sessions we've been having before now. But today we want to talk about the software as a service company. What is peculiar to the software as a service company? And then I just finished explaining that for a traditional company, the unit economics are very straightforward. You just break down for every product that you're going to sell, what is the unit price? What is the unit volume? Sorry, what is the total units or volumes that will be sold per period? You know, based on maybe factory size, staff strength, or market size, based on a combination of those important things. And then what's unit cost? And with that, we can easily project forward the revenue, the cost of sales. But for a software as a service company, so let's now go look at a software as a service company. An example of software as a service company is Salesforce. How many of us know what Salesforce does? So Salesforce is a software company. It's a CRM company. So if you work in a very large organization, there might be a likelihood that your company already uses Salesforce for their CRM. There's also, let me look for another one that is completely, I don't want to pick a company that doesn't, there's also Twilio. Twilio is another company that, thank God, I can show you the pricing. So you see how they sell their products. So these companies, they are not like a car company or a physical product company that you can go and buy and, you buy it once, you own it. And they can compute and say, this is the cost of producing this product you have bought. And no, what they do is they do a kind of a subscription base where you pay. Let's look at the Salesforce one. So Salesforce products. I'm looking for pricing. Because it's important you even understand the distinction in the business model that makes it pricing. That makes it important that we have to create a model structure that aligns with that business. So for Salesforce, they have products that are tailored to different sizes of companies. So let's go for one of their most popular products, right? Let's even pick this small business. And let's look at how they price it. Can you see? So I'm going to zoom my screen. You can see that there is Essential, right? Which goes for $25 per user per month. There's another one that goes for $75 per user per month. What is important for you to know is the fact that you are paying based on a subscription plan. That is what separates them. You are following all the customers. They don't just buy it once and own it for life. That's what differentiates. Something like that is into food business. You can easily say this is the cost of producing it. This is how much they get back from one unit sold. But when you're modeling for a SaaS, software as a company, software as a service company, right? You cannot use that because they keep selling you this. You don't pay once. You pay. You keep paying on a cycle, like monthly or annual cycle. And also the thing that they sell to you is a bit difficult to say this is the cost of producing it, right? So you want to use a model that captures these things that are specific to a software as a service company. And so we are now going to start talking about their own lingo. They have there's a way we talk about the things in software as a company, software as a service company. So let's just go and look at the model. So you find out the things we have to adjust majorly are our inputs. So in the other company that is not software as a company, right, I did not have to break the inputs into monthly separately from annual, right? I can decide to do everything on a annual or everything on a monthly. But when you're doing for software as a service company, it's really prudent that you do monthly, especially for a new, for a startup, because things are going to be changing really, really fast. You know, so even if you do the other cost annually, you will want to do the unit economics. Remember what I keep calling this units. Unit economics, you will want to do it on a monthly basis, right? So the breakdown of the, you know, revenue, you know, broken down to capture customers and to capture their own particular costs. So we have what we call the average revenue per customer or average revenue per user, and we have cost of acquiring customers, so customer acquisition costs. So these are things that are peculiar to software as a service company. Let me just check if anybody has dropped in any questions. Okay, all right. So if you have any questions, just, you know, you can always drop your questions and I will see them. Okay, so we are about 7 in the meeting. Well, I'm already recording, so those who join later, they will be able to access the recording. So for a software as a service company, this is how it works. Now, if you are a Salesforce or you are a company that your product runs on a subscription basis, there's, first of all, you need to capture how many new customers you get. So how many new customers have you gotten this particular period, right? So those new customers that you get, there's usually a cost to getting them. So for software as a service companies, they aggressively market because they know that when they get you, you keep paying on a monthly basis. So there is usually a very high cost to acquiring the customer, and there is a logic to it. You want to calculate what's the lifetime value of the customer, and then some companies benchmark or earmark, say, 30% of that. If we know that the lifetime value of our average customer is 20,000 naira, we can say we are okay with spending 5,000 naira to acquire a new customer. And so what do? We can do things like bonus. You know, when you sign up, we give you 1,000 naira worth of voucher, of credit, of discount. Or we can decide to say every existing customer, if you get a referral, we are going to give you a coupon of, say, 2,000 naira. That's, you know, maybe 1,000 naira for you, 1,000 naira for that person that you've brought in. So that you must have been coming across some of these kind of marketing schemes. And it's a very common thing because that is, they are using it to follow in line with their marketing plan of let's get in new customers. The more customers we get, and the more we try to keep them, so we reduce the level of churn. Churn is customer came in last month, he paid for last month, but cancel their subscription. So if you use Netflix, you know, it's not sometimes you cancel your subscription. That month that you cancel your subscription, you become a churned customer. And you know what they do is, gradually they'll start sending you emails that, okay, you know what, come back, you pay for the medium plan, that one where only two screens, and maybe you cannot watch a 4K screen. But you know what, when you come back and you pay for that, we'll give you the higher value. Or sometimes some will say, you know what, Apple Music will say, you come back, we'll give you 1 month free. So they monitor that because they want to bring you back in. So they try and keep track of their churn customers. So again, it's something that is very, very fundamental to the business model. Your model, your financial model must also capture it. So then for every customer you have, what is the average ongoing monthly cost, monthly revenue? You know, how much does this customer give you on a monthly basis? So, you know, if we charge, say, 5,000 naira per month, then that can be our monthly. Okay, no. That what I'm just saying now is this one, average revenue per customer, right? So if we charge just one price point, if we charge just one price point, right, then you'll find out that that price point it can easily become our average revenue per customer. But if we have different price points, if we give discounts sometimes, if we have different product categories, maybe we have standard, we have professional plan, we have ultimate plan. So when you look at all of that, you take the weighted average and use that to come up with what is your average price point. Or if you know that your products are not too many, you can decide to call product one as the standard plan. And decide to call product two as the professional plan. And that way you will just put the price. But for some companies that they have a lot of products, maybe like you saw me show you for Salesforce, Salesforce has a lot of products. You know, these are all the products they have. This is one of them. So the small business is one product. It might not make sense for them to start calling every plan as a product in their model. So if they want to do their forecasting or their financial model, it might be much more manageable to pick the average that people be in this pay in this particular product plan instead of you now having, you must see if you have product as this many, which is like work.com is one, small business is two, sales. In fact, let's just write them. So imagine this is one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. These are already 15 products. You don't want to go and start making all of these as if they are products again, right? So it might be okay to just pick the average revenue of all the people on your small business product. All right. So, but if you only have one product like Netflix, then you can decide to put all those plans as separate products. Okay. So let's carry on. So you find out that for a software as a service company, you want to capture new customer, the cost of acquiring a new customer. Then how many of your customers that you have already are in the monthly renewing? So existing customers, customers that you already have, you know, if without you having to do anything, they are paying. They are able to, they keep paying for their every month they keep renewing. So that kind of that's why their business model is really interesting because if you give a good product, most of your expenses will be in acquiring customers. Once you acquire them and the customers are happy with your product, they keep paying. It doesn't cost you to keep those customers. Unlike if I go and I buy a furniture from a company, even if I like that company, every time I go and buy a new furniture, it costs them a lot of money to make that furniture to get to me. You know, the where the mall, the shop, the furniture shop where I go to buy it, you know, they are paying rent there, it costs them to put their products there, the wood, the marketing. So they don't have any way of distinguishing between me, who will buy it, even if there's no marketing, even if there's no furniture warehouse that I have to go and pick it, if I have to go and pick it from the company, or if I can be on a plan where they can ship it to me, you know, directly from their company. But for a software and service company, internet makes it such that once a customer is happy with your product, you don't need to do anything more to keep them, you know, they keep renewing. So you only focus on those ones who are no longer paying. So that way, you know, your cost of or your cost analysis is a bit different from a traditional company. And then you know, the average revenue you make, and also there's the monthly renew recurring revenue, which is a, the new customer plus the already renewing customer times how much you make per month or per period. So for February, where you already have new customers and you have existing customers, so the new you got that month plus the already existing ones that are renewing times how much your product cost on a per month subscription plan. And that gets you the monthly recurring revenue. So this is the nature of the unit economics for a startup that is in the SaaS, the software as a service segment. So any question on what I've said so far before we start looking at how we take all of this and using in finishing of the model? Okay, so no questions. All right, so I carry on. Okay, so we now take all of this and bring them into these scenarios. So we create that well, these are plans and things don't usually pan out the way that we plan. So let us create like a best case, worst case scenario, be able to see like a range of outcome. So I can say, okay, what will happen in my best case scenario? And I see the range of outcome. And then what will happen in the worst case scenario? So we can see the range of outcome. And that way, all this will flow into the financial model to help you see how your income statement, your balance sheet, and the cash flow will come out based on all of those assumptions. But you know what? It is the assumptions that we have plugged in from this monthly input sheet that captures this unique way software as a service companies, their lines of items are. So let me just be writing out the peculiarities. Peculiarities of software as a service company. So there is one. You want to capture new customers differently from existing. I used to work for a subscription base. So I used to work with Airtel one time around 2011, and it was in the value-added services. So it was a subscription. This is coloring back tunes. It's just later far into my career, I started realizing why we are capturing record that way. So we're always capturing, new subscription renewal. So we capture new subscription, new customers, which is equivalent of new customer. Then renewals, people that renewed. And then we capture churn, people that churned, and then we capture what's our active base. So all those things, it's a peculiarity to every subscription-based business. All right, so we capture these differently, or renewing customers, different. Okay. Yeah. And number two is there's always a cost, customer acquisition cost that is attached. So then we had the country managers who used to create their plans and say, okay, they plan to get 20,000 or 50,000 new customers or subscribing. And this is, they need maybe 1 million naira to run campaigns. They are going to spend 500,000 naira on SMS campaign, SMS that will go to people who are not registered on our platform, who are not using our service, and we tell them, oh, this new song, you can subscribe, you can put it as your coloring back tune. And then they will say, okay, we're going to do billboard advert or so. All those costs are to get new customers. Those costs are not to go and advertise to people who are already on your platform, right? So that's what this customer acquisition cost is. It's a cost that is always attached to getting new customers. So that's one thing that is peculiar to a SaaS company. Then you know that you already have the renewing or existing customers. So you capture them separately, existing or customers that are renewing. So in that period, while I was there, we used to call them renewers. So those who are renewing customers. And then we also capture the churn, those who have stopped using our service. Depending, normally you want to say if someone has not used your service for 30 days, well, in a normal software as a service company, that customer has churned. So you want to quickly start intervening. You don't want it to be too long before you start intervening. But in then when we capture for active base, we used to say if you have not used our service for 3 months, or was it 2 months? But if you are a purely SaaS company, 1 month is better. Then there is the average revenue per customer. So what's the average revenue you make per customer? Sometimes we call it average revenue per user. So whether APU or APC. So then in that company, we used to call it APU, average revenue per customer. Then also we used to calculate lifetime value of customers, because that's what we used to peg how much you want to spend maximum to acquire a new customer. So there's the monthly recurring revenue. So the money that you should be making monthly from these customers that subscribe this month, with the expectation that they will subscribe next month. Okay. And then usually you want to calculate your lifetime value of customer. So to do this, sometimes we want to get what is the average life span. So do customers stay with you for 1 year? Are they 2 years? Do they on average stay with you for 4 years? So if they stay with you for 4 years on average, then multiplied by how much you make from them for that 4 years, that gives you the lifetime value of the customer. And then from there, you can start pegging your advertisement and some of your marketing and even costs to that, so that you don't go and spend too much to get a new customer or spend too little, because the differentials between that is the profit that you make from that customer. So these are the peculiarities to SaaS. Let me just paste it in the chat box, because those who will be watching the recording, they can access the chat box. Okay, all right, so now that I've talked about that, let's continue with the peculiarities. So this one fits into the scenarios, and that's what you use to capture, for different scenario, pessimistic, optimistic. So this, okay. All right, so the other thing that is peculiar to call software as a service company is they do not have inventory. Number 10, they don't have inventory. Let's go and check. I think I have Facebook. Let's start with companies we all know. So I think I have Facebook opened somewhere around here. Salesforce. I think this should be Facebook. Okay, this is Amazon. No, Amazon is not a software as a service company. I think this is it. Yeah, so this is Facebook. So let's go look at the structure of Facebook's income statement and balance sheet. Okay. Now, are you looking at this balance sheet? Can you see anything that says inventory here? There's no inventory. A software as a service company does not have inventory. Okay. So that's one thing you need to factor in when you're doing your modeling, your model inputs. So what that means is that when you want to factor the what we use for forecasting inventory, you have to explicitly state there that it will be zero. So the day's inventory outstanding is going to be zero. Software as a service company does not have inventory. It can have receivable, which is from the day's sales outstanding. So receivable is people can owe software as a service company money. In fact, currently I'm owing Microsoft for Azure. Azure is the software that I'm consuming. I've not paid for the last period that I've used. So it will be showing up as receivable on their own side because I've not paid. I've used it. They've recognized it as revenue because they've delivered the service to me. But then I have not paid. So they give me like a grace period of I think maybe a month. They keep sending me like almost daily reminders that my payment is overdue. Even if you use Google Adverts, similar to, you use it before you pay. Sometimes you don't pay on time. They only disable your adverts, but the one that you have done already is done. And they keep sending you notification that you should pay. So yes, they can have receivable, which is these days sales outstanding. Maybe it takes them 5 days to collect all of their revenue, or they can have payable because yes, they can hold their own suppliers, they can hold their contract developers, they can hold people who supply them services in the company, even people. Whatever things they buy to keep up as a company, they might not pay exactly on time. So that shows up in the payables outstanding. They can have payables, but they never have inventory. So the moment you are doing this, you want to consciously ensure that inventory is always zero. So that's Facebook. Let's go look at that. And that's how I am. Yeah, this is Facebook. Let's look at another company. Yeah. So let's go look at Twilio. So what Twilio does is, it's a company that most of these companies, online companies, use to deliver you SMS. So when you sign up on a service and they say, okay, we need you to enter in an OTP, we'll send it to your SMS. So for not Nigeria, not banks, for most global company, the Twilio is one of the is I think they're a leader in that area. So they makes it possible for you to as it for developers to programmatically connect your their app with SMS so that they can SMS to the customers, whatsoever message they want to pass, usually OTPs or notifications or stuff like that. So they do that, and then recently they started doing also emails too, so you can get email. So they are very big in that space, such that they are even listed on the stock exchange, right? Now let's go look at their own financial statement. So this is their financial statement. You see, can you see active customer accounts, right? And then they're able to capture what's the base revenue based on the active customer account and how much they charge on. So you find out that this is the pattern that it is for all these software as a service company. If we go again to the balance sheet, I'm sure you're not going to see inventory there. So let's just go there. In fact, if you look at this cost of revenue, it's majorly that cost of acquiring customer, the cost they incur in getting a customer. Then also for them, because they are already very big, so platform costs, also comes in there too. So platform cost in terms of the resources, what they pay the network providers, what they so. But the larger chunk is that cost of acquiring the customers. So for a startup, most times they bundle everything into that. So you can break that cost of acquiring customers to, platform cost, marketing cost. Then if you now know that your own you need still, unlike Facebook, where they might not ever incur any cost to service you, you know, on any variable cost to service you. So what they will just do is that cost of acquiring customer, and if they sell content, they can prorate the cost of acquiring the content to a per customer cost level, so that it becomes like cost that will feature before their gross profit. So let's just look at the one I was trying to point us at, the balance sheet. Any questions so far? I hope it's not boring. Maybe I'll just stop showing all of this. I just want us to be aware of the difference, because these kind of companies are not so common, but they are beginning to become more common as we, especially if you are a consultant like me, or you intend to do this thing on the side for other people, you'll start coming across businesses that this is the nature of their own operations. They are subscription based. Well, it's proving difficult to locate the let's use this one. So let's use Salesforce. So Salesforce, again, look at the asset side. Huh? You can see the current asset, right? If you look at everything that makes up the current asset, nothing there says inventory. Nothing there says inventory. So that should settle it for everybody that a software as a service company does not have inventory. So you have to be very deliberate to remember that. Okay, so those are the things that are peculiar, you know, in absolute terms about a software as a service company. So I'm just going to post this again into the chat box. So if you want to do a model for software as a service company, you want to ensure that you capture all of that. So right now I'm going to just do a brief walk through the entire model as I've built it, capturing those peculiarities. Okay. Any questions so far? We have reduced to 5. So go here. I'm going to put my screen in a kind of full screens. Yeah. As usual, you have the summary sheets. Afterwards, the table of contents, which is to make it easy for people to navigate through the entire model. Then the model input sheets monthly. So here we are capturing those unit economics in month by month, right? Okay, and I've already talked about this. Then whatever other things we want to capture on an annual basis, the general and admin expenses, sometimes they are just easier and better captured on an annual basis. If any change, you can always change. Some of them even pay on an annual basis, things like rent. Sometimes even insurance, you pay them annually. So sometimes it's much more realistic to capture them on an annual basis rather than capture them monthly. There's only a few things that you might be paying for monthly. Okay. Then marketing expenses, people typically have annual budgets that spreads into monthly or quarterly budget. So this mirrors the pattern that we use in capturing them. So that's why I have to separate out the monthly separate from the annual, so we can capture things on their much more realistic periodicity. So research and development, a lot of them, software as a service company, they spend on R&D. Maybe they acquire some research, or they acquire some kind of patent or whatsoever, you know, that goes under R&D. Then there's the tax rate, then loan, you know, tax also is paid on an annual basis. So that's why it doesn't even make sense to go do monthly for tax. No, you don't pay income tax on a monthly basis, you pay annual. Similarly for loan, you know, most times you are discussing loan, it's every serious loan is usually on a year on a year basis. Personal loans that sometimes are done on a monthly basis. So this makes sense for loan. If there's any bank overdraft, if you raise any equity and you commit to paying dividends, you know, and since you're not going to be paying dividend every month, so you see why the annual one makes sense. Then the capital expenditures, okay? So in the different categories. So for a software as a service company, buildings, so you can get to a stage where you want to buy your own building. So a lot of all these big software as a service company, they own their own HQ. They even have campuses. So you've heard of Google Campus, maybe Facebook Campus, Apple Campus. You know, they have places that they own themselves and they are able to, so because they have that much money. So you too can decide to buy your own. You can buy a duplex in Ikeja or in Lekki or in VI, and that becomes your company HQ. Then equipment, so you have two categories of equipment. So let me put this 5 years, it should be 5 years. So you will have equipment that their lifespan is longer than the typical laptop, the typical ICT, the typical user ICT equipment. So we capture those differently. You don't have plant and machinery. Most of what you will have, maybe you have servers, you have some other things that are used in providing your services, but are more of like very expensive and more longer year span than the typical laptops and printer that you buy for the office use. Then vehicles, then office furniture, then patents. And we already know this, how many days it takes to collect your revenue, how many days it takes you to pay your suppliers, inventory, you do not have inventory for a SaaS company, then other current assets, other current liabilities. Then we go to fleshing out the staff cost and director cost. So whatever you are paying your directors annually, you know, by how many you have, how much you're paying the CEO, the finance director, head of IT, software engineers, project managers, business development manager, HR manager, customer account managers, social media managers, receptionists, and the scenarios that I already shown us. Then from there, we get out the revenue schedule. So these are things you're familiar with based on the previous sessions we've had. So the revenue schedule is now built off those peculiar lines of the software as a service company. Then cost of sales, again, is built around those peculiar lines of the core software as a service company. The only thing is just that we might add cost of revenue. Cost of revenue that is beyond just the cost of acquiring customer. Okay, so that would be not all companies that we have it. Okay. And then there's the working capital schedule, there's the depreciation schedule. Depreciation schedule. Which is the typical depreciation schedule, so nothing different from what we already have. There's the debt schedule that captures how you repay your debt. There's the equity you raise. There's the tax, capturing the tax that has to be paid. There's the income statement. There's the balance sheet. There's the cash flow statement. So these are all the normal ones you have in the manufacturing company. The only part that is different for a software as a service company is just this. You have model inputs that flows into scenario 2 and revenue and cost of sales. So these are the parts that needs to work alongside the peculiarities in a software as a service company. So I've come to the end of my demonstration for today, is to start you on understanding the difference between software as a service company and the traditional companies that we have, so you do not go and use the approach that is meant for a traditional company. You don't go and use it for a software as a service company. Okay. Isiano is asking for the recording. So as for the recording, you will always get the recording in, let me just grab you the link. So the recording will always be in, well, we put it on YouTube, but we have a channel where we always put the office hour recordings. So let me just grab that link and share to you. Why is it taking time? Okay, great. So if you go to this, post this here, so we'll have the recording. So that's the link to the recording. Okay. Then Abiodun is asking, what drives the price of a typical software as a service company? Is a separate model built to determine price? Most of them, there's always a market price for the service you are rendering. You cannot say you want to do a kind of Netflix and you go and set your own price different from what Netflix and Iroko TV and DSTV and all those other ones, Showmax, are setting. So there's always a market price that you try to align with. So it's not like you just go and randomly pick a price somewhere. A lot of times there's the already, what you are doing is not the first in that industry, except if it's the first, that's where you can use a different method to come into the price. But when it's not the first, you just have to follow the pricing pattern of your competition. Okay, so that's it for Abiodun. All right, so without any more questions, we are going to round off today's session here. Thank you for joining, and I hope to see you next week. And as usual, if you want to do our classes, do our training, and have access to all of those templates and some other things that we only give for our training students, you know, you can sign up for our classes at, and we have free classes. Let me try and grab you the link for the free classes. So there are some that are free that you can even take without having to pay. Okay, yeah, for free classes. So thank you very much and see you next week. And that brings us to the close of today's session. All right, so ciao, bye-bye. See you next week.